Our understanding of Edwardian Britain is dominated by images. We can see it in flickering footage of the time, in formal family portraits. But apart from a few famous voices, the people themselves remain silent. We can see the Edwardians, but we can't hear them. But there has been a remarkable discovery which for the first time gives voice to our ancestors, and it has come from the most unlikely place, Germany.
There were a man and had two sons.
Hundreds of recordings have come to light which reveal the voices of British prisoners from the First World War.
No one to welcome me home, but when I return towards Ireland again.
Father, I've sinned against heaven and again you. I no longer the worthy to be called your son.
I'm going to return to the hometowns of these men and meet their families. How does it feel to hear one of your relatives speaking to you from nearly a century ago? And how much have all our voices changed since Edwardian times? What do you think the placement of a Geordie accent is? Where it's formed in the mouth? What the mouth shape's like?
Well, to be honest, I wouldn't know. The thing that strikes me about a Geordie accent is the tune of it, mm-hmm. that it goes up at the end of the sentences. But I have to say, for someone like me, Geordie is probably the most difficult accent.
I have an unusual job. I teach accents for a living. I teach accents to actors for theatre, television, films. In the time I've been teaching, I've taught over 350 accents. It can end on an up, it can end on a down, it can end wherever you like. But it's got to have that direction about going over the wave of the North Sea in order to get there.
Right,
to do with that. And I think, too, that there's much more variety of tune in a Newcastle accent, don't you, than in most other accents. I mean, you'd get a thing that a lot of the lads are like speaking really low down, but there are a huge number of the women that actually can move about an octave within a sentence. Try saying to me, Jim caught, this is a long one to remember, Jim caught six fish with a stick. At the weekend, keep going over the top.
At the weekend.
Exactly, so you've got that glottal going with a K. The weekend with Jucky.
Right.
And that helps you enormously, doesn't
Jucky.
It?
Jucky.
Yes. Okay.
Jim caught six fish at the weekend with Jucky.
Good. The British Isles has a rich tapestry of different accents. Over the years, I've come to feel connections between the way we speak and the scenery that surrounds us. It seems to me that landscape dictates or has something to do with the tune of an accent. It certainly feels true that the flatter a landscape, the flatter the accent. The area of East Anglia being a perfect example, which is probably the flattest county geographically and has the flattest accent. So there's a feeling like in East Anglia, you take a few steps forward, little step back, another little step forward, and it stays very much on like two or three notes, which could contrast very clearly with somewhere like South Wales. The hills and valleys, where we're travelling from the valley over the top of the hillside onto the other side. And so there's a feeling of expansiveness. One of the most interesting factors in accents, to me, is whether the tune is in major or minor key. Good examples of that, to make that clear, would be Birmingham, which is absolutely in minor key, so I could go on and on, end where I like, but never ever end on a definite note. So you hear that sort of dull minor key ending, as opposed to something like North Yorkshire, where I'm ending very, very much on definite notes, and I'm bound to sound more sure of myself. A career of listening to voices has taught me how quickly accent and dialect, the particular words local to each region, change over time. To find out how people used to speak in the past, I'm dependent on old recordings, and the further back I go, the fewer there are. Sound recording was in its infancy in the Edwardian era, and so was reserved for the great and the good. This is what makes the discovery of recordings of ordinary soldiers from World War I so remarkable. I've come to Berlin to find out more about these recordings of British prisoners of war. Just 4 years ago, author John Adams came across them by chance while researching local dialect.
I first came across these recordings through a book in the British Library. This book was called Cheshire Mundart, Cheshire Dialect. It was published in 1938, and it referred back to recordings made of prisoners of war during the First World War. These recordings were said to be in Berlin, so I wrote to the Humboldt University and asked them if the recordings still existed. I got a marvellous reply back. If I told them what I wanted, they would send them to me. So I phoned up the British Library Sound Archive and said, were they aware that these recordings existed? And they said no, and if they did exist, they were of national importance.
Miraculously, these fragile records, made from a brittle resin called shellac, survived the devastation of Berlin during the Second World War and are still there today. Hidden away in a corner of the city stands the archive which holds the recordings, overseen by sound and music expert Jürgen Marenholz. He has dedicated the last 8 years to a meticulous process of cataloguing and filing. How many First World War recordings do you have here?
Oh, we have 1,650 shellac recordings.
Oh, wow.
Here at in our archive.
And how many British prisoners of war does that include?
I think we have 200 recordings on shellac discs.
So if I said a county to you, you could just pick something out of the cabinet?
Yes, for example, we have...
if I said Dorset.
Yes, Dorset, for example. The code number is 467. Yes.
So this is it. This is the first one I see.
Yes.
So this is a recording of Dorset. What
yes.
does that say?
It's of the south of Dorset.
Right. And the recording is of, written in handwriting, the recording is of the farmer's daughter. Farmer's daughter, is that right?
Yes, it's right. And the code number is PK467.
The recordings were masterminded by two men. Alois Brandl was an Austrian academic fascinated by British accents and dialects, whose research trips to this country had been brought to an abrupt end by the outbreak of war. Wilhelm Dürgen was a sound specialist whose dream was to create a museum of languages and music from around the world. In the first few months of the war, several thousand British soldiers were captured and taken prisoner in Germany. They were held in dozens of camps stretching across the country. As the war raged, Dürgen realized that on his doorstep was a captive resource. These camps offered him a unique opportunity to record the speech and music of many different nationalities. Seizing his chance, Dürgen put forward his plan to make recordings of the prisoners to the German authorities.
The Germans would have been very keen to exploit the resource of all these prisoners of different nationalities who had effectively landed on their doorstep. They would have had access to a huge range of ethnic groups, of languages, and of cultural traditions, which would have made it very interesting for ethnographers, musical historians, linguists.
Permission was granted. Between 1915 and 1918, Brandl and Dürgen formed part of a team of academics who toured over 70 prisoner of war camps, recording around 250 languages and dialects. For Brandl, this was the perfect opportunity to study his favourite subject, British accents and dialects. For the prisoners of war, however, life in the camps was harsh.
The physical surroundings of camps varied greatly. For the ordinary soldiers, they were often not unlike in perhaps some of the camps that they'd experienced at home in the British Army, but they were often of a far inferior standard, usually hutted accommodation, possibly with up to 20 or 30 men in each hut. They'd be very, very cold in the winter, and German winters can be extremely cold, and these men didn't have access to warm winter clothing in many cases, or they'd lost their warm winter clothing during their capture. So they would be wired in, there would be sentries, and in some cases there would also be dogs patrolling the outer perimeter. So it was an extremely oppressive and very unpleasant place to be incarcerated.
For 3 years, Brandl and Durgan devoted all their time to this ambitious project. Travelling from camp to camp, they recorded one prisoner after another, building up a vast archive of voices and keeping detailed written records of each speaker.
It's fantastic to see this at last, and I really can't wait to hear it. Can you play it for me?
Oh, yes, I can do. Oh, that's a recording of Sydney Wilkins.
But how can you know the speed at which to play it?
The last groove here has an A.
Yeah.
And I can control this A with our tune fork here. And when the speed of the recording is right, I have the same tune from this record.
And right.
Now the...
So now you're adjusting the speed down here.
Yes, there's the pitch control.
Right.
And now you hear, it's the same tune,
yes.
And now the record is ready for...
So can we hear Sydney?
Yes. Now we can hear the real voice.
She's all the farmer's daughter, the beautiful, I'm told, whose parents died and left her £500 in gold. Her uncle kept the ploughboy, whom Mary loved so well. And in her uncle's garden, the tales of love would tell. There were a wealthy squire, who oft came her to see, but still she loved her ploughboy on the banks of the sweet Dundee.
What do you think about this recording?
Well, that's amazing. I mean, I don't know what Sydney would think about us listening to this now.
Yes, yes.
If I listen to his recording, I mean, if I do it from my clinical, more scientific side, if I listen to that recording and you asked me where he came from in England, I don't think I would guess Dorset.
Ah,
I would guess somewhere deeper into the West Country. Because he sounds almost like Somerset nowadays. Mm-hmm. These sounds he makes like Zummer and Varmer, these mm-hmm. F's to V's and S to Z's, really belong deeper into the West Country.
This is our number, PK108.
The text most frequently recorded was the parable of the prodigal son. But the prisoners also recited poems, told local stories, and sang songs.
John and I'll tell me, John, when we were first acquainted, you looked a light raven, your bonny blue was there, but now your ball is bald, John, you looked a light the snow.
What do you think about that?
I'm very emotional. Very emotional, because it's a very typical Scottish song, and it's about the song's about longing.
Mm-hmm.
And it just touches me about longing for home. You just hear the yearning in the voice. And it sounds exactly, the accent sounds exactly as you'd hear someone from that area now.
The recordings had an educational purpose, to document for the German nation the speech and music of the rest of the world. But was there a greater plan in mind?
How did they get the finances? Mm. Because particularly at that time, during the war,
Yes.
There wasn't a lot of spare money around, presumably.
Yes, the first 2 years are spent by the German government.
Really?
Yes, because this was a colonial area of Germany too. And they thought at the beginning of the First World War that they that they do not lost this World War.
Oh, so they thought that they were going to they thought they were going to come to all these places and pass themselves off as native speakers of Dorset. So this is the devious plan, is this?
When they have the good recordings, they can train all the people who go to the new colonies.
Do you surmise that? Do you guess that, or do you know that?
I know that because it was the purpose of Wilhelm Dürgen, and that is written down in some readings, that this was also to train, well, these recordings were also made to train the person who go to the...
to the colonies, yes, or to parts of England.
Aha.
There was a man who had two sons. The youngest of them said to his father...
PK737 was a recording by Philip Jarvis of The Prodigal Son in March 1917. We know that Philip was born in Macclesfield in Cheshire, but few other details are known about him, and no photographs have survived. I've come to Macclesfield to meet Philip's family. I don't really know this area, so first I'm keen to get a feel for the local accent. When I'm studying an accent, I try my best to get into the heart of the place and the sensibility behind the people as well as just the sound.
I would never believe that we've got an accent in Macclesfield.
Oh, you have.
But we have. Yeah.
So I can't understand it half the time.
I stand at bus stops. I queue in the post office. I go into pubs. I go into community centres. When I come into bars, I often have a tape recorder hidden in a pocket. It's not always feasible to do that. So I usually find myself a quiet corner, listen to people, and I write down phonetically what I'm hearing. Everybody's talking about the darts, Bowood. This is my favorite diphthong. So I can write that down phonetically. So I see my diphthong here is ua, like in sewer, but which we'd never expect in this context of Bowood. So at least I've learned how to say the dart Bowood. Philip Jarvis grew up in a gamekeeper's lodge in the countryside, so I want to get into the heart of the rural community to hear how that accent sounds today. I love coming places like this when I'm researching an accent. I'm full of anticipation, full of excitement about what I'll find. I've never been to Macclesfield before, so I have an idea of what the accent's going to be like. I hope it's going to be my expectation, so that it's going to be a very physical, grounded sound. I suspect that members of the farming community hold on to the accent far more and hold on to the dialect more. They recognise the dialectal words because they're a community, because they don't see as many people outside their own working environment.
This is Bianca.
This is Bianca, the cow.
Yes,
is
it? Very naughty.
So you've spent a long time cleaning her up, have you? And are you a farmer?
My husband's a farmer, yes. I go out to work full time as well.
But not as a farmer.
No.
Did you buy any cows today?
No, sold two.
And how much did you get for them?
Nearly 1,000 for one, and 700 and something for the other one.
And have you been selling as well, Mike?
No, I've just come to to look for some straw, that's all.
How much do you pay for straw?
Too much, yeah. 40. Between 40 and 50 pounds, depending on whether it's barley or wheat.
I've had a fantastic morning here, really, because there's such a sense of community amongst the farmers. And I really feel that the accent is possibly much less changed in a group like this. Perhaps because farmers' children spend more time with their parents and are actually obliged, really, to work with them. The accent carries on a lot with the, along with a lot of the other traditions.
And the young man said to his father, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against thee, and am no longer worthy to be called your son."
I'm about a mile from where Philip Jarvis grew up at Alderley Edge. He spent the first 25 years of his life here, and his father was a gamekeeper, so he was very much part of this land. He also came back here after the war. I've never been here before, but if I'd made a guess on listening to the recording, I would have guessed that it was a place with a lot of openness of space, because you can feel space around it. You can hear it in the quality of the tone, that the tone quality is very open. It's not nasal at all, like Manchester, where you hear the nasality, Manchester being just over there, you hear that sort of whiny quality. Whereas in this part of Cheshire, the tunes are very down to earth. You can't imagine an accent from an area like this being lazy in any way. This is organised, beautiful. So I've got a lot of better bits of butter. That very firm, grounded tea seems to fit with it. And these incredibly rich diphthongs. It wouldn't make sense to me that somebody said they looked at something for hours and hours. They look at it for hours and hours and hours. I've come to meet the Jarvis family, who live just 3 miles from where Philip was born. So you're all related in some way to Philip Jarvis. And, Michael, you're the closest relation.
Yes, my grandfather, my great-grandfather and Philip's father were brothers.
And he didn't marry himself?
No, I believe Philip was a bachelor. There seemed to be a few lost years from when he came out of the army, when he got demobbed in 1919. There's quite a few lost years to when he died.
But you know nothing about him at all?
Not from that time. He was a blood relative, like, you know, and he probably had it rough in the prisoner war camp, and he went through a lot. A lot of people don't actually realise what them poor souls went through.
He was in service, what they used to call service, and then in the army. And he doesn't know what family life is, and we do appreciate what we've got.
And you're a very close family, aren't you?
Our family now, this is my wife Marion, my son Darren, Nicola, granddaughter Jordan, have two more children, 9 grandchildren, and it's just one big happy family.
Well, there's one other thing that we do know about him. We know what he sounded like.
Yes.
So would you like to...
Oh, yes,
definitely.
There was a man who had 2 sons. The youngest of them said to his father, "Give me that part of your thing that belongs to me." So father gave him his share. Not many days after, the young man gathered all his belongings together and went away into a far country. There he wasted all that he had. When he had spent everything, a great famine came over the country, and he began to be in want. High time is it that I should go back to my father. This day I will start for one, and I will go to my father and say to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against thee."
Well, I know your old recording sounds frightened to death, though.
You think he sounds very frightened when he's making it?
I mean, The old word his mum and his father. Like, you know, his mum, like, you know, but it was. Oh dear. It is very, very.
Very emotional, that. It sounds frightened. And
how did you feel about listening to Philip's voice for the first time, Nicola?
I kind of find it quite harrowing, just thinking that, you know, he's the same kind of age as what I am now, and listening to the circumstances he's in there. And
he sounded a lot older than what he is to me.
Yeah, he did sound older. It's just, I just
like
find it really...
Man, to me, he sounds a lot older than 30s, because you can hear guys, the older guys round here, and some of them, they still speak like that. It's unbelievable.
Absolutely. So does he sound quite country to you?
Yes, he does,
his accent?
Yeah. Because there's a couple of farmers that used to go in a local pub and they would speak like that. It's just like listening to them again.
Is there anything that surprises you about the accent at that time that you wouldn't hear now?
It's a lot stronger.
When I arrived here, I had this memory of Philip's voice in my head and this idea that it so seemed to fit the countryside, where you see, I mean, everything's very beautiful and neat here, isn't it? But I suspect that accents have got a bit more, I don't like the term lazy, but a bit more slap happy. How would you say the word H-E-R-E?
H-E-R-E, here.
Darren, how would you say the word here?
Here.
And what would you say, Nicola?
I'd say here.
What would you say, Jordan?
Here.
Right, you speak like your mummy, of course you do. So there's a very big movement in vowel sound. So here is two sounds, isn't it? Ear,
yeah,
and yours has become one sound. Here, yes, yeah. You do. Yes, you're.
Yeah,
yours
I say,
is
oh, I'm over here,
first.
Or come over here.
Yeah. Mm. I think, Nicola, that you have quite a lot of Mancunian in your accent. Would that surprise you to hear that?
It does really. Yeah, like I say, I've never really. I don't think I've got any accent.
My impression of the Macclesfield sound is that it's very down to earth, and your tunes are much more sort of floaty, that they don't actually end somewhere definite.
I have a nasal problem.
But you sound as if you have more of a Mancunian sort of tone of voice, which is not a criticism in any sort of way, it's just a comment.
Try and get down there
you're
every
common.
Other week to go Primark, but...
No, it's all the parties, yeah, isn't it?
It's very different reading about somebody and reading the facts and figures and
actually
hearing somebody's voice. I feel as if Philip's with us in this room
yeah,
now.
Yeah, I hope he is.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
it. I hope he is, and then he knows that, you know, we've heard him, because I'm sure when he was doing, you know, reading the story, wondering if anybody's ever going to hear this. Is anyone going to listen to it? And 90 years on, we've listened to it.
What do you think about him telling the story of the prodigal son?
I think it's marvellous, really, and how we feel now. The prodigal son's come back. His next birthday, we'll raise a glass to him.
I can't help wondering what some of the prisoners felt like when they were making these recordings. Some of them sound frightened, hesitant, nervous. I think they must have been rather suspicious about what the recordings were for. This is the only photograph that exists of a recording being made. Brandel is standing in front of the speaker and the other prisoners are awaiting their turn. The text is being held up by Durgan, who has one hand firmly behind the prisoner's head, directing his voice towards the trumpet. Brandel, who oversaw the recordings, is quoted as saying, "This is the work of peacetime. We will not talk about the war. Nothing will happen to you if you are unwilling to speak." Well, that's reassuring. He also says, "We sought out the farmers' lads from isolated farms, the fishermen from tiny harbours, the shepherds, and above all those who were almost unable to read or write." Local dialect, in the strict sense of the word, is restricted to those of low intelligence and is consequently deficient in intellectual content.
That's a very judgmental thing to say, isn't it? Brandel may have had a questionable attitude towards his subjects, but he was passionate in his desire to chart accents and dialects across the British Isles. He was part of a pioneering group of academics working in this new world of phonetics. The British linguist Henry Sweet worked with Brandel. A founder of modern phonetics, Sweet is thought to have been one of the models for Henry Higgins, the professor in Pygmalion. Brandel's fascination with this country also brought him into contact with one of our most famous writers. Brandel, in his travels investigating accents, had a connection with Thomas Hardy, and actually he sent some of his students to meet with him and remarked in his book on how helpful Thomas Hardy had been with them. Thomas Hardy's writing was steeped in the language and traditions of the countryside. He had a passionate love of the West Country, and his writing made heroes and heroines of ordinary country folk. One of the strongest rural accents I've heard amongst these recordings comes from Wiltshire. Charlie Shears was recorded in May 1916, aged 24.
I'm doing my duty manual. Eyes right, eyes front. Lord love the old the head up. And if the stirs to answer my back, I'll bung the in the lock up.
This is Cricklade in Wiltshire, where Charlie Shears was born, grew up and returned to after the war. Charlie loved it here. He was a farmer. He felt at one with the landscape. Charlie's gentle, rural burr reflects the undulating, rolling nature of this landscape.
I wish I were back warm again, a-milking our old cowser. I wish I were back warm again, a-driving our old closer. I wish I were back warm again, a-vour a leg of mutton. We a darn girt knife and a rusty old bark, Lord love the good knife cutting.
In Charlie's time, Cricklade was at the heart of the farming community. Today, with the industrial town of Swindon just 10 minutes away, it's a commuter town. Charlie's sister, aged 98, still lives nearby and remembers her brother well. So you're Mrs. Bartlett, you're Charlie's sister, and this is your daughter Helen, who's Charlie's niece. Can you tell me some memories of Charlie when you...
Well, my mum told me that he should have been in school, but he skipped school. And he lit a firework and he threw it through the window and it landed on one of the kids' heads, oh, burnt all his hair off.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, that's true. And that is when the copper chased him and his friend, and they come to a little stream. Well, they didn't have a proper bridge, they had a board about like that. You had to cross on the board. They got over the board, the policeman was behind, they went like that, and he was in the water.
And what did he say to them about that?
Oh, he told them, he said, I've got a great respect for your parents, but I think you two should join the army.
Oh, so is that why he joined the army?
That's right, and then Charlie joined the reserves. That's how he was called up when the first. Kitchener's Army. I think that's what they called it.
And when Charlie went to war, he was captured early on.
Yes, and I remember my mum saying that he'd gone to Germany. But he was okay, because he never wrote bad to her. No, he never wrote anything bad.
And did he go with some other boys from the village?
Yes, he did go with friends. I think he, only he, him... Only,
oh, sorry.
Only Uncle Charlie came back, didn't he?
Yeah, he came home on my birthday, and he bought me the prettiest dress I've ever had. Oh, it was lovely. And it was the church... Where we went up to the church, went on the people's lawn, you know, and had tea and buns and stuff, and that was my birthday.
Am I right in thinking that Charlie tried to escape from the camp?
He did. He did, but they caught him.
And what happened?
They stripped him and tied him to a tree. Well, he didn't tell us that, but his mate did. He'd tell us the funny things, but he wouldn't tell us the, you know, things like that. He said when they were helping the Germans pack the loaves of bread for the people, they had baggy trousers. When they weren't looking, they had half a dozen in their trouser legs.
You don't remember your uncle at all, do you?
No, only as an older man. I can't remember him when I was a child. Well, he must have been about 60 when I was born, so... But I can remember him being very upright, ramrod straight. You know, I suppose that was being in the army. He was a lovely man, but very dry sense of humour.
Do you remember Charlie's voice?
No, I don't think I can. No, I was looking at a picture of him and I couldn't remember. No, I couldn't. I should have remembered, but I can't.
As you know, we've got a recording of your brother Charlie, and I'd like to play it to you.
There were a man as had two sons. The younger on them said to his father, "Give me the part of the goods as belongs to me." So the father given his share. Print many days after, the young man put all his belongings together and went away to a far country. There a wife did all of that. When I had spent everything, a great famine come over the country and I begun to be in want. A hour long, I had to check any work I could get and I were glad when I found a place with a man of up country.
I wouldn't have recognised it.
Can't believe that.
It's possible he's speaking in with more dialect than he normally used.
Yes, I can't remember.
Because it's very, very thick.
Oh, my goodness, yeah.
With his girt.
Feather and girt and summer. I think that's more Somerset than Wiltshire.
I wouldn't have recognised his voice.
I wouldn't have recognised his voice at all.
I wouldn't.
No, I don't think many people speak like that. You know, unless you go to a village where somebody's lived all their life and never moved out of the village. That's the way Wiltshire people did speak. Not so much with the Zs for Zummer. I can't remember that, but I can remember elderly relatives talking with that strong, strong accent because they never moved away from their villages.
Exactly.
They always lived in the same village and everybody spoke the same. It's very interesting, isn't it? Mm. I mean, I can't believe that I've actually listened to him speaking in those circumstances all those years ago. It just gave me quite a shiver down my spine. Yeah.
The recordings I've heard so far have been a revelation. The accents and dialects are so much stronger than I'd expected. I've come to get a second opinion from one of the country's leading experts, Johnny Robinson.
Brandel and Durgan spent a huge amount of time recording the prisoner's speech in the form of phonetics.
Mm-hmm.
Can we just have a look at the phonetics that they wrote?
Yeah.
Because although it's written in what looks like very rapid handwriting.
Yes.
I think we can read it from the phonetics that we know today.
That's right, this is fascinating text, isn't it? Because this is at a time when linguists like Durgan and Brandel and people in the UK like Henry Sweet, who I believe worked with them, were formulating a sort of national, international convention, if you like, for how do we write sounds. And it's a very early version of what has become the International Phonetic Alphabet, so it's a fantastic early glimpse of how that came about.
The men who were recorded were given the text of The Prodigal Son and asked to change any words or expressions into their local dialect. Do you think that would have put pressure on them to invent dialect to some extent?
It would be interesting to know, wouldn't it? Because, yes, I suspect if they were given a text and given time to prepare, then they may well be drawing on expressions, perhaps from their grandparents or people they knew back at home, rather than just necessarily using the expressions that are natural to themselves.
Let's listen to Philip Jarvis from Macclesfield. He's telling the story of the prodigal son.
There was a man who had two sons. The youngest of them said to his father, "Give me that part of your things that belongs to me." So father, give him his share.
He's got more dialect words, probably, than any of the other speakers that I've heard. I mean, I'm interested particularly in his use of feather. Can you tell me something about that?
That's right. That's a very traditional broad dialect pronunciation that was widely heard in the Northwest Midlands from that sort of area. And we still hear other dialect pronunciations, don't we, to this day? We hear father in the north, for instance, in Yorkshire and in Lancashire, certainly. And that would have been the original pronunciation in the northern half of England, father. And that vowel sound was gradually lengthened over time. You hear father in parts of the north now, and certainly you hear father in the south of England.
Perhaps. I'd love to play you a recording we have of a man from Oxfordshire.
Wonderful, that sounds fascinating, yeah.
There were a man as had two sons. The younger on him said to his father, "Yoy, that part of your goods that belonged to I." So the father gave him his share. There he got rid of all he had. When he got rid of everything, a great famine came over the country.
What do you think of that?
It's a wonderful recording, isn't it? Yeah. I suspect to modern listeners that would sound as if it was from somewhere in the West Country or somewhere Devon, Cornwall, Dorset sort of accent it sounds like to modern ears, doesn't it? But it's very typical of speech in Oxfordshire, Berkshire, Buckinghamshire of that sort of date.
So do you still hear the R pronounced after vowels the way it is on that recording?
Yeah, he says father, doesn't he? And he says adder words with the R pronounced on wherever it features in the word, doesn't he? And that's something, again, that is typical of speech in the West Country these days, isn't it?
So do you feel that the nature of rural Oxfordshire has changed?
Absolutely. I mean, Oxford is not very far away from London, so large parts of the southeast of England have changed quite dramatically, haven't they, from a rural community to commuter populations. And that's changed the nature of speech in rural communities in lots of areas in the southeast of England.
Johnny, having heard these recordings, what are your thoughts?
Well, it's been fascinating to hear them, hasn't it, and have a glimpse of dialects of that time. And certainly things have changed since then, perhaps more dramatically in some parts of the country than others. But in terms of accent, things have evolved very slowly and there is still a great deal of difference as you move across the country in terms of accent. So it's been great to be able to hear slight differences and also perhaps find a bit of a link with the past as well.
In addition to the English voices, Brandel and Durgan made 44 Irish, 4 Welsh and 74 Scottish recordings. We now know that rural accents have been affected by the spread of cities into the countryside. But what has happened in the more remote corners of the British Isles? George Campbell, who was recorded in July 1916, was born and brought up in Aberdeen. But the town has changed dramatically since then, as oil workers have moved in and the fishing industry has declined.
45 again! 45 again! 45 again! 45!
It's all haddock nowadays.
Yeah, it's all small haddocks.
So there's no cod around to speak of?
No, very rare. Sometimes a bit of head. They've got bigger markets than us. We only get the bucksy stuff. Like the small
Do
boats
you?
Here, all the big boats go around them.
All right, up the road.
Up the road.
Up the road to Pierhead.
45 per one, 45 six, 46 pound, 46 seven.
What's that cost? 60?
That's £45 a box. There's 51 kilos in there, so it's 80 pence a kilo.
And have you always been in the fish?
Yeah, since I was 19 I've been in the fish and there's been massive changes. I mean, some days there's no fish in this market at all.
What I hear in the fish market is an accent that seems to me absolutely unchanged. It feels as if it's centuries old. It's not just an accent, it's a dialect, it's a whole code, a way of speaking. It's impenetrably thick. Every accent's got a point of tension, and it's very clear in the Aberdeen accent. I was brought up in Aberdeen and left when I was 18, and I've still got that point of tension. It's here. It's the upper lip that's very, very immobile. It's something to do with it being the Calvinist coast, about just covering up your orifice, don't look inside my orifice. It's definitely something to do with that. But it's also the fact that it's bitterly cold here. So everybody's sort of wandering around like that, sort of shielding their mouths against the cold. The essence of the tone quality in Aberdeen is that it lacks nasality. This is common to ports. People do suffer from sinus problems. They sound as if they have a bunged up nose. So it happens from Aberdeen, you hear the tone quality like that, as if I'm not breathing through my nose, into somewhere like Liverpool. Although you've got a different tone quality, you can hear that I sound bunged up. Or even like New York, it's almost like I've got a cold. I'm sure that George Campbell would have walked along this beach. Everybody who's an Aberdonian walks along this beach at some point, and it's usually deserted. It's interesting that when he was asked to demonstrate something of his dialect in the prisoner of war camp, he chose three Scottish songs. He's got a beautiful voice, beautiful tenor voice. He chose three incredibly nostalgic songs by the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond, Coming Through the Rye, and John Anderson, My Jo John. They're all songs about longing for home.
When we were first equipped, you looked a later
evening. I've come to meet George's son, Alexander Campbell.
Your father was a very musical man, wasn't he? Do you have memories of that?
Yes, particularly if I say he played the banjo. I can recollect him playing in the dance bands, mostly Friday or Saturday evenings, as it was in those days.
I believe he did tap dancing as well, yes, is that correct?
There's evidence that he did have the tap shoes with the rattly taps.
So he was multi-talented in the musical field.
I think he was the one that would have a go at probably anything. I've got some photographs I managed to bring out of the old files.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Maybe the first one is my mother and father, probably not long after they were married.
Oh, that's very nice. And your mum looks very young.
Young, yes. We have one or two from what would appear to be concert parties where he's dressed as the dancing comedian.
Oh, I see.
And that's an enlargement of the same, of him only.
So this is George Campbell, light comedian and dancer.
Correct.
Oh, that's fantastic. You look like your father, actually.
Well, probably some of the features are there.
Yeah.
Now, this is probably the most intriguing one. It's actually in the camp.
Oh, wow. There's the German guard.
Eating
with
time.
Meal time, and the German guard's got the cigarette between his
very
teeth.
Casual looking, but very dirty looking, weren't they?
Mm-hmm. But it looks very casual, doesn't it?
Yes.
And if they're kilts with aprons over them.
Correct.
There are so few photographs of the prisoners who were recorded. It's just fantastic. I think there were more recordings made of your father's voice than of any other man that I've heard. So
That's
your
surprising.
Father's
son. Maybe not surprising.
And your father was obviously
first volunteer
and a fantastic example. Right. And then they made all these recordings of him, whereas with other people they made one or two. Your dad was pretty unstoppable when it came to his recordings. And this is the first song that he.
Bonnie Banks of Loch Lomond. By yon bonnie banks and by yon bonnie green, where the sun shines bright on Loch Lomond, there me and my true love spent many happy days on the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond.
Very good. It's quite intriguing the way it's come over.
So, is there anything that surprises you listening to him?
No, I could understand, I could picture him singing that.
I find it very touching, you know, this sort of sound of Scotland.
It's sentimental stuff.
Yes. Yes, but I mean, very, very kind of personal stuff.
It's odd hearing that. It is odd, yes.
What, like it's a ghostly voice from the past, or...?
It seems trying to link it to what I have by way of any recollection or anything. Yeah.
Your father sings John Anderson Majo, but he also speaks the lyrics because these Germans were very interested in the accent. Right. So I'd like you to listen to a bit of his speaking voice.
I haven't heard of that. You know, you didn't ever recite poems or anything, but it'd be very interesting to hear that.
Right.
Song entitled John Anderson Majo. Now you're an outcome, John, eh? John Anderson Majo, John. When we were first acquaint, your locks were like the raven, your bonny brow was bent. Now we might thought of doing John, and hand in hand we'll go, and we'll sleep together at the feet, John Anderson the Joe. Now you're an outdoor John, eh? What do you think of that?
That last comment sounds like him.
Does it? I can't quite hear what he says at the end. Mm.
I wasn't clear, but it just sounded the way he would say something just off the cuff.
Yes, so it's a wee bit cheeky at the end of the recording
for
the Germans.
Take it up whether you like it or not.
Yes, take it or leave it.
That's right, yes.
Does it make you sad at all, listening to it?
In a way, not dramatically sad, because it's such a long time ago. But to hear the voice even, the fact that it's there. Mm-hmm. Because apart from a few remnants of photographs and things that we have, and certificates, there really is nothing left, is there?
No.
It's a long time ago.
There are a couple of copies of the words of the Bonny Bonny Banks of Loch Lomond.
Uh-huh.
Would you read the first verse to me?
Read it? I'm not going to sing it. Anyway, by yon bonny banks and by yon bonny braes, where the sun shines bright on Loch Lomond, there me and my true love spent many happy days on the bonny, bonny banks.
Bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond.
These voices sound so familiar, singing songs and telling stories about their homeland. It's easy to forget the speakers were imprisoned in Germany.
What was being recorded in this country at that time?
In this sort of period, most of our spoken voice recordings are of famous people, so statesmen, politicians, royalty, that sort of thing.
And any women?
We do have some recordings of women. We've got a very early recording in 1890, for instance, of Florence Nightingale, and we've also got a recording from 1908 of Christabel Pankhurst.
The reasons why women should have the vote are obvious to every fair-minded person. The British Constitution provides that taxation and representation shall go together. The excesses of men must be avoided. They must be compelled by a united and determined women's movement to do justice in this matter. We are resolved that 1909 must and shall see the political enfranchisement of British women.
Oh, that's fantastic. It's fantastic. But it sounds almost exaggerated with its I, mine, A's and...
That's right, one or two slightly, what we might now feel are slightly old-fashioned vowels.
I love the way that she belches out the vowel sounds, and the vowel sounds being the sounds that carry the emotions. Mm. So she says things like, the excesses of men must be avoided.
That's right, it's very clear and crisp, isn't it?
Very clear and crisp, and it gives the vowels full value, although it's very, very clear on the consonants.
That's right.
You mentioned to me earlier that you have a recording of Shackleton.
We have, yes, from 1916, I think, yeah.
And was he middle class, southern?
He was. He attended Dulwich College, so again, he was very much middle class, went to a boarding school, traditional boarding school.
Could I listen to him?
Absolutely, yeah.
The British Antarctic Expedition left New Zealand on the 1st of January 1908. We retraced our steps over crevasses through soft snow. On the 3rd of March, a party ascended that mountain, and for the first time in human history, the great mountain Erebus, 13,350 feet high, was ascended by men.
That's so interesting, because he's much less grand than I imagined he would be. I mean, obviously he's got a lot of very grand sounds, with his man sounding like men.
That's right.
And he talks about the time rather than the times, which one associates now with somebody who's trying to sound grand, the dry white wine syndrome.
Right.
But what I'm so fascinated
by is that to my ear they sound quite neutral, as if they could almost be of now.
That's right, there are one or two elements there that don't sound out of place nowadays, aren't they, in the way he speaks?
No.
It's such a very familiar voice, that sort of early broadcast voice, if you like, that the BBC adopted. But as you say, there are one or two vowels that sound slightly old-fashioned. He talked about falling on his hands and knees, for instance, where most speakers of his social standing nowadays would say hands, not hens. So there are one or two things that sound old-fashioned, but lots, as you say, pretty modern, really.
I mean, I suppose I've got this idea that sound has, accents have neutralised as time's gone on. So I've assumed that the sound of the 20s and 30s was maybe less strong than the Edwardians, but actually it's quite the other case, isn't it? We've got this neutral sound in Edwardian English, and then the Noel Coward sound, the very, very clipped, upmarket, jolly sort of sound that came after the war.
That's right, I think that was very fashionable at the time, wasn't it? It was a part of a certain social set, and certainly heard very much in that period.
It's fascinating to know more about the accents of the middle classes at that time. But there is a strange irony in the fact that I've learned so much about how ordinary people spoke from a German sound specialist and an Austrian academic.
The significance of these Berlin recordings is that it's often the case that we think of the First World War as a silent war. We see silent film, silent footage of grey figures doing soldierly things, but we don't actually hear their voices. So it's very exciting to hear young, contemporary voices speaking about not necessarily the war and their military experience, but providing us with some idea of what our ancestors sounded like.
And it said to his father, "As many years have I served you, and have always done what you told me to do, but you ne'er give me even a kiss."
So what have I learned about how the Edwardians used to speak? Certainly they articulated their words and didn't drop their H's and T's as many of us do now. But there's no doubt that regional accents were stronger back then, and as cities have grown and our lifestyles have changed, they have become diluted.
Rural accents are changing all the time as towns spread into the countryside and youngsters in the country want to sound more and more like city kids. At the same time, new accents are emerging in the cities. And this is why I find this area so exciting. All these years ago, Brandel recognised this. He said, "We do not stand before a peaceful sea, but before an ever-changing stream."
It's incredible to hear these voices speaking to us from so long ago. It almost feels as if they're coming back to life. In some ways, these prisoners of war were the lucky ones, who at least had a better chance of making it home. But despite the joy of getting back, for many, the horror of World War I overshadowed the rest of their lives. Philip Jarvis was one of these men, forgotten by history. He died an unremarkable death at the age of 67, living just 10 miles from where he was born. 5 years later, the stone marking his grave was moved and more bodies were buried in his plot. Today, Philip's curbstone lies in a nearby garden. But now, his voice, along with hundreds of others, lives on. They are living and breathing again, telling stories of returning home.
But this, your brother, was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.